Okay, today we've got another mechanism challenge. We have our starting material and we have this product. We have the reaction conditions. So we know everything that's involved, but we want to know how it's going to happen. So we got to write every single electron pushing arrow. Exactly how is this going to proceed? So take a moment and give it a shot. Okay, taking a look here, we see some very interesting structural features. We've got these two five-membered rings, but then on the product, we've got this five-membered ring, which appears to have remained intact, but then this has become a six-membered ring. So this five-membered ring is now a six-membered ring, and there's an additional six-membered ring. And nitrogen is part of both of those two six-membered rings. So definitely we're going to look over here to this azide, and that's definitely going to be doing some chemistry. So the first thing we have to do is understand exactly what N3 is. So what exactly is N3? We've got N, 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 like that. And so this one has a minus charge, and this one has a plus charge. So that's what this functional group actually is when we see N3. And so what that means is that this nitrogen is actually, right, it's only got two bonds. It's got two bonds and two lone pairs. So if it makes an additional, if it acts as a nucleophile and makes an additional covalent bond, it's going to go to three bonds and one lone pair, which is ideal. So this is ready to attack something. And it just so happens that we've got a carbonyl nearby. So let us attack this carbonyl. And we're going to kick that up there. And in doing so, we are making a seven-membered ring, right? We're making, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So let's go ahead and draw that seven-membered ring. Whoops, we're going to want the pen tool. So that is going to be N right there. And the rest of the azide is still there. This one's still got a positive charge. We've got a methyl up here. And then we've got, boom, 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 boom. We've got O minus. We've got a methyl here. And we've got another five-membered ring there. And that is a methyl. And that's CH2OH. So, Not too tricky here, right? Just nitrogen attacked the carbonyl, popped open the carbonyl, formed that new seven-membered ring. Now, here's where the real interesting chemistry happens, because we know that we can close up that carbonyl, but we're going to have to pop something open, right? We're going to, if this carbon accepts this pi bond again, it's got three sigma bonds here. One of them is going to have to break. We could break the one that just formed and go back to where he went. That's not very interesting. So what if we could open up something else? Now, where is another portion of the molecule that could be a driving force here? We've got this nitrogen with a positive charge. So watch this. We can satisfy all of the formal charges here in one fell swoop. If we close that up there, and then let's take this sigma bond and kick that over here. So this is going to detach from, this carbon is going to detach from this carbon and is instead going to coordinate to this nitrogen atom. And the reason that this is thermodynamically favorable is that this can then kick that off, and we are going to go straight to the product, losing nitrogen gas. So nitrogen gas is lost. And look at what we've done. We have made this ring one carbon smaller, and we have made one unit smaller, I should say. And then this ring has become one atom larger. So the seven-membered ring has condensed and the five-membered ring has expanded. And that's great because we are going to two six-membered rings, which are more stable than seven and five-membered rings. Remember, six-membered rings, all the carbons are perfectly sp3 tetrahedral, 109.5 degree bond angles. So that is the optimal ring size. So the two driving factors here are, number one, going from 7 and 5 to 6 and 6, and two, we get to neutralize this nitrogen atom and kick off N2, which, by the way, also is entropically favorable. So those are essentially the three factors that are driving this, and we're just going to go straight to the product, and that's all it is. So a pretty short one, but just two interesting things, or really one interesting step, but just number one, N minus from the azide attacks the carbonyl, kicks that open. And then obviously the interesting step is that the carbonyl reforms, and then this this carbon will shift and coordinate to this nitrogen instead, so that we go from 7 and 5 to 6 and 6. So that is today's mechanism challenge.
Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.